Hey, what's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another video, and today is a video that I really didn't expect to make. We all pretty much knew that Apple was coming out with their own chipset, and we learned that they're going to start with the Mac Mini and the MacBook Air and base MacBook Pro, and we'll start to see their Pro lineup hopefully begin next year. And to be honest, this is the first event that I actually missed watching because I had a video gig at the time, and so I was catching up afterwards on social media, and I was like, oh cool, everyone really seems to like what Apple announced. And you know, I looked into it, and sweet, new Mac Minis, new MacBook Air, whatever. And then people start getting them in their hands and talking about how amazing they are, and I'm seeing fellow content creators like, man, this thing is pure magic and it can do unbelievable things. And so honestly, I just had to see what all the hype was about. And so today we're going to test the base M1 Mac Mini versus my nearly $9,000 Mac Pro. Now, just to get everyone up to spec speed here, this is the base 8-core Mac Pro of 160 gigs of RAM. It's got the 580X standard graphics card, as well as I added a W5700X for a total of 24 gigs towards the video RAM. And both of these machines have the base 256 gigs of storage. However, I did add a 2 terabyte NVMe SSD into my Pro. So all the tests will be done on the Pro, with the footage being stored on the NVMe SSD, and on the Mac Mini, it'll be stored on the desktop, except for the last couple tests, which we'll talk about, which are just way too big to store on 256. So, and by the way, I don't do benchmarks. You're not going to see any sort of Geekbench, whatever. Who cares? I mean, your computer scores a million points. Great. What does that actually mean? The only like benchmark test that I actually ran, which I think is actually useful, is a Blackmagic disk speed test, because especially for video production, this directly correlates to how well your timeline playback is going to act. And I was actually really surprised. The write speed on the Mac Mini is actually nearly double of what is on the base Mac Pro. Now, I believe the base Mac Pro's 256 is slower than the 512 or up, but again, I'm using an NVMe SSD, which gets about 3000 megabytes per second, both read and write speeds. So again, that will help playback, which we'll talk about later on. All right, so let's get into some testing here. And I wanna talk about this, like what I'm gonna call the single clip fallacy that we see in so many YouTube videos, where someone takes some crazy footage or file, drops it into a timeline, and goes, look, this computer can handle this footage. For example, I downloaded Ursa Mini Pro 12K B-RAW files, and I threw it on the Mac Mini. Guess what? It plays back okay, not in full resolution. You can get it to play back just fine with a couple little optimization tricks. But just keep in mind that while you're watching this video and every other computer review video out there, that there's a huge difference between a computer being able to handle a couple clips or a small test project, and then there's like feature films. Very, very different use cases. Now let's talk about where the Mac Mini is magical. So the very first test I did was I took one of my YouTube videos and I exported all the individual files as ProRes 422 files, because Final Cut doesn't read B-RAW files, which is what I shoot in. Basically just did an export of about a 20-ish minute video. For what we were just talking about, like the single clip fallacy, this falls in line with like the easier of the test benchmarks, where it's just a bunch of clips thrown on a timeline, let's hit export and see how it does. And to be honest, I forgot to track how long each one took, because I'm used to resolve exports where it actually tells you how long it took. However, keeping an eye on it, the Mac Mini actually beat the Mac Pro's render time by about 5 minutes. And throughout the entire export, it consistently stayed 10 to 15% ahead of the Mac Pro. Now, touching upon the customizability of this computer, if I was a Final Cut user and shooting and editing in ProRes all the time, I would buy the Afterburner card, which would probably then destroy what the Mac Mini could have done, and it would have exported probably twice as fast. And so that is one of the reasons why I love the Pro, but to be fair, in this specific testing with what I have here, Mac Mini won that test. And so yes, I have an extreme bias in this video. I just spent like $9,000 on this computer a couple months ago. I want to see this thing struggle and die. Now for the next test, I wanted to move out of Final Cut, because to be honest, we all know that pretty much any Mac out there is optimized incredibly well for Final Cut. And so I'm like, okay, Resolve, let's go. And so I opened up one of my full YouTube projects here. So this is just a 4K timeline, but it's got a full color grade on it. I actually added a decent amount of temporal noise reduction. And similar to the first Final Cut test, What I did here is export them both at the same time and just kind of let them do their thing. Now, since Resolve actually tracks the time it takes to export, I actually have some numbers for you. The Mac Pro exported in 26 minutes while the Mac Mini did it in 39. Now, I know what you're all thinking right now. Michael, you really expect anyone to pay $8,000 more to save like 12 minutes or 10 or 15 minutes of export time? No, I wouldn't. Because while export time is incredibly important to someone like me who is literally editing multiple times a day, but what you're actually paying money for is the experience. You don't want any sort of playhead lag while you're moving the playhead on the timeline you expect it to keep up. If you're adding a clip or moving a clip, disabling a clip, adding a color correction, all those little moments that take half a second, 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds for the computer to load whatever task you just did, that adds up a ton. What should have taken 3 or 4 hours to edit was now taking 6 to 8. So in the next test, what I wanted to do is simulate some multitasking. So what I did is export the same exact timeline, except this time, while I was exporting, I was like, hey, you know, what do we do while we export videos? We usually work on a thumbnail. So I opened up Photoshop and started working on that, doing some random content aware fill, not actually trying to make it look pretty, just trying to do some processor and GPU intensive tasks. And I know you could say this is somewhat unfair for the Mac Mini because Adobe hasn't optimized their software to take advantage of the M1 chips yet, but to my surprise, Mac Mini had no problem with this. It opened up Photoshop super fast. It was doing content aware, basically on par with no delay, just like the Mac Pro was. I then pulled up a 4K YouTube video, did picture in picture, put that in the corner while I kept editing the thumbnail as Resolve was exporting in the background. And the Mac Mini did an amazing job at essentially transferring the power wherever I was working. But this did come at a cost, because as I started watching the 4K video and messing around in Photoshop, I kept an eye on the progress bar in Resolve in the background. And what was going to take about 40 to 45 minutes now was going an hour, hour 10, hour 20, because what it was doing is essentially giving less power to Resolve, because it was like, hey, this is running in the background, I gotta slow down because he's trying to do a lot more stuff in the front end. Meanwhile, the Mac Pro was chugging along nearly the exact same export time, around 26 minutes. Let me give you the exact numbers here. Yeah, and so the Mac Pro actually only took 2 milliseconds longer to render while doing the multitasking task. So it finished in 26 minutes and 15 milliseconds. As soon as I stopped doing the Photoshop stuff and watching the YouTube video, which I did for about 10 minutes, of course, Resolve picked back up and it quickly was able to recover its time and took about 46 minutes to export this time. So only added on about 7 minutes in total. And obviously this is where having the 16 gigs of RAM version, you'll fare a lot better, but still massively impressive on the 8 gig. Screensaver, continuity, ugh. All right, but like I said before, I wanted to make this thing burn, and so I wanted to see what step it would take for it to really crush itself. And surprisingly, it only took one more step. Went to YouTube, searched 8K video, and watched some Switzerland beautiful scenery shot in 8K video while exporting the video while Photoshop was open. And that basically made the Mac Mini unusable, filled up all the RAM, all the CPU and GPU usage, and the screen was basically bogged down. Nothing froze, nothing quit, and nothing crashed, but you definitely weren't doing anything else, and it took a handful of minutes for me to actually close the video and get the video rolling again. Meanwhile, roll an 8K video on this on top of all the previous mentioned tasks, no problem. All right, now let's keep climbing the ladder here and talk about where the Mac Mini struggles. So I opened a project that I worked on last year. This was a music video that we shot with the Red 8K Helium with anamorphic lenses. That doesn't really matter for the sake of the files, but I love me some anamorphic. Now pay no attention to the actual color grade. I couldn't find the actual final color grade. So for the sake of this test, I wanted color grades on there with noise reduction and everything, but I didn't spend hours through stuff on it. And this is one of those project files of why people buy the $50,000 Mac Pro, because even this computer can't play back the full timeline resolution in 239 at 8K. And so I have it set up here for a 4K 239 aspect ratio. And still I have to view this at half or quarter resolution for the timeline playback. But then it pretty much does fine. I can keep the color grades, the noise reduction all turned on. I can edit. I don't like to make a lot of proxies or optimized media just because I'm turning over projects so fast. But if this was a more longer term thing, then I absolutely could do that. Now on the Mac Mini, opening it up in the same format breeded very different results. I could not get this thing to scrub through the timeline smoothly or anything until I turned off all color grades and effects, so noise reduction included, and played it back at quarter resolution. And so yes, it is impressive. If you needed to work on this project and you only had the Mac Mini, then yeah, you could do it. And again, the 16 gigs of RAM probably would fare a little bit better. Probably not a ton better because it's more of a GPU limit. But yeah, you would definitely have to create some sort of optimized media proxies or change the timeline resolution, maybe even to HD, to get it to play back with the color grades turned on. I don't want to go too in depth to this because it's pretty obvious, but keep in mind, these are very different designed boxes. This one is a thing that you cannot open up, you cannot change. It has one HDMI port, two Thunderbolt 3 ports, and like a gigabit Ethernet and headphone jack, I believe. Whereas this one, you got custom RAM slots, you got custom PCIe slots for more GPUs, for NVMe SSDs to mount. I have like 6 to 8 Thunderbolt 3 ports, 4 HDMI ports, headphone jacks, USB type A, USB type C. You see, when I worked in Apple retail, we were trained to ask a bunch of leading questions to help people decide what computer is right for them. There are two types of computer buyers. There's the I want to buy a computer that is going to suit my needs now, and I usually upgrade every 1 to 2 or 3 years. And then there's the, I'm spending a lot of money on this computer, so I want to buy this and have it for as long as humanly possible. And with a lot of tech, phones, tablets, and whatever else, I'm a 1 to 3 year type of person. But with computers, I want this thing to last like a decade. So the fact that this is fully swappable, pretty much every component, I am very confident that I will have this for the next decade. So if you're a content creator, whether you're starting out or you're an existing one, and you pick up something like the Mac Mini and it's suiting all of your needs, fantastic. Truly, this is an amazing machine and it deserves all the credit that it's getting on social right now. And I can only imagine that if this is the cheapest base Mac, the Pro lines coming next year, those are going to be just like pure witchcraft because Apple is the king of optimization. I did everything I could to throw at it to kill this machine and nothing really killed it. If you are a Final Cut user, then you're probably gonna be fine no matter what Mac you choose. So I'll leave you with this. Do I regret buying the Mac Pro a couple months ago? Do I wish I waited until next year for whatever they're going to announce? One, that's a little hard to tell because we don't know what they're going to announce. But no, I don't regret it whatsoever because this is doing exactly what I need it to. It's handling all the projects I can throw at it. It is a total beast of a computer and it's customized to my needs. If I need it to do more, I can simply add to it without having need to sell and buy a whole new system every couple of years. But yeah, let me know what you guys think down in the comments below. I'm curious on your thoughts are on the Mac Mini, how it stood up to the Pro. I'm sure this is going to be a very fun comment section. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next video.